しやよ、おへやよ、しやよ、おへやよ、へやよ、
we need to honor the earth. The ancestors said the Creator put a spirit in the earth. The soil and the spirit creates the plants that we use for helpful purpose. And we give thanks to the spirit of the earth when we receive those plants from the earth.
The best way to honor anything that you take from the earth is to bring together the spirit of the plant and your spirit that God gave you when you were born and have a communion that is the best and the strongest way that you can honor what the Creator placed on the earth.
Long time ago, when I was younger, people talked a lot under the shade tree because we didn't have no fans or air conditioners. And so a lot of people, older people, when they come to visit my family, they would sit under shade trees, especially in warm weathers. I like the shade tree because it always provides a place for them to talk. And so they talk about this trees that long, long time ago, there was so much tree that you couldn't see the sky. And so you'd have to go a long ways to see a little bit part of it, because there's a lot more trees then, because there were no open areas like they do now for cattle or anything like that. And so they had, it was kind of like that, where you could walk under it long ways off. And I guess it's a pretty good area too, kind of cool area to be, and also the weeds and stuff underneath there was not so high or abundant, so it's pretty bare ground. And so people walked on this long ways like a kind of protection. You might say. So all this land was kind of preserved with everything in it. Well, healthy land provides a lot of stuff, food and plants and animals. And so it has a lot to do with food and healing, I guess you could say, and well-being. This one called Udlosin. It's kind of like a blackberry type thing. And that's one of the fruits they had out in the woods they could get. And so they had a lot of stuff in the woods. They had other stuff like huckleberries, and they had like a wild blueberry, and then they had other plants like watercress. So they had a big old place to get stuff in the woods. So it's like a big Walmart. So they live off the land, in other words. I guess you could say that there'd be quite a big loss if it's ever gone. So I guess when you say it that way, it's kind of, there's a lot of loss to it when all these plants go. And these plants were provided by Creator too. So they were there for them to use. And so I guess you could say a lot of cultural stuff will go, and a lot of way of life will go. And it just kind of leaves it kind of in the openness to that rich cultural heritage. You know, the way of life and what they did and what they created.
I took this picture because my grandfather would sit by the spring to watch bees. Grandpa lived about a half mile up the hill. We lived downhill. And in between there was a spring, and everybody used that spring. Grandpa would sit by that spring for about 2 weeks. What he would do was watch the bees. Now that spring was surrounded by clover and honeysuckle. And he would watch the bee as they come in and then get a drink of water. And then he would watch them which direction they went. So he would go that way in search of honey. And so he would find the honey. It was usually in a hollow tree. And then he would ask Daddy, you know, let's go get some honey. But what they did was they just got enough for a few jars, and then they left the rest for the bees to have. And so we would, they would bring it back, and then we would strain it, and then we would put it in jars for our winter use. Our winter use was for like sweetener for different things and medicine, like cherry bark or hickory bark. And they would put honey in there for cough syrup. Those were some of the things that I thought about when we first started doing this. Health really comes from the land and how we take care of the people and the land. And all thanks to the Creator put it there for that purpose. There's a lot we've lost already, but still yet, it's time to take care of what we have now. That spring that was so pretty, right now I can't find the spring because different people bought the land and then they just turned the cattle loose in there, so they just tromp it down to even with the rest of the land, and you can't tell where the spring has been.
This photo is red oak tree, and we used the bark for, like if you got bad colds, that's what they used it for. And they just get the inner bark. It's different from the white oak, and the bark protrudes out, and then you'll have creases, and the leaves are slick, smooth, and we call it the adaya. They call it adaya, which means the real trees in Cherokee. That's the white oak or post oak, Jusk in Cherokee, white oak, Jusk. And you got, that's what they use, same way, combine that with the red oak and the white oak and the hickory bark to make a tea out of it. That's the hickory tree. One day it would be hickory. And that goes with the red oak and the white oak and, you know, they use that. That's the leaves. It'll have about 7 leaves with the hickory. Okay, this is the wild cherry. And cherry will be tītāhia. You can use this just by itself, and it'll be one of the strongest drink that you can get. And it's for your colds. You know, if you got congested, that's what they used to use. There's 4 things, like I said, the red oak, white oak, and hickory, and wild cherry. They mixed all those together and boiled it. Both of my parents knew the herbs as medicines. My father used to tell me that all the plants that we see is medicine, but a lot of them is, you know, is we've lost the knowledge of it. And every plant was important to Cherokees. You know, we don't know half of as much as our ancestors did. But, you know, they didn't have hospitals, and that's what they used these plants to keep healthy. And we need to learn from that. You know, if we eat more wild foods, and if we use the medicines that our people used, you know, it would be in a healthier state, and the only way we can preserve it is, you know, we got to protect it. And there's few areas that you can find all these medicinal plants, but you know, there's a lot of farmers and ranchers. You know, they'll just cut everything out to raise cattle, and the Cherokees didn't like that. when I was growing up. That's where Cherokees used to hunt, and now they can't go in there. That's where they used to gather, you know, even to go look for wild onions. And that's what was important to our people. It still is. You know, you can't go in those places anymore. You know, we need to preserve our area somewhere. We're losing a lot of our culture, even our language. And the language goes along with our culture. You know, we've got names of all these trees and plants and our environment that we have. And if we don't protect that, we're going to lose it all. I've been advocating for a number of years, and it's to have our own national park. We can call it Cherokee National Park. But we need large acreage just for our environment to go back to a natural state. And it takes a lot of work, but I think it would be beneficial to really start thinking about something like that. Set aside, you know, 10,000 acres. If we had that much acreage, we wouldn't have to worry about losing it. Somebody bulldozing the trees and plants and everything away and putting cattle in there, destroying the environment. You know, we could protect that for our future generation. You know, it's never too late to do that.
This is a picture I took of a sassafras, and it has a lot of medicinal purpose. The Cherokees use it a lot. And I took this photo by the house going up our road, and we have a bunch that grows back behind our house. And I was told by the old people that it would help your kidneys. My daddy was a great medicine man. My father used to tell me that Indian medicine heals from the inside out, while the white man's medicine just kind of dulls the pain, or it doesn't really, really cure you. It might stop it, but Indian medicine, every Indian medicine or Cherokee medicine that we have heals you from the inside. All kinds of medicine that you take from the woods, you do not take all of it. You take what you need and leave the rest, and then you have to ask God and the little people and the medicine keepers that are there in the woods, and you have to tell your clan and what your name is, your full Cherokee name. And just, to me, I just kind of pray over the medicine before I take it. There's a lot of land clearing, you know, for cattle. You know, cattle just got to have land. And people just go in and doze the place, never researching what is being destroyed by clearing land or making highways. I mean, where does it stop? I think that Cherokee Nation and anybody that's in a position to preserve the medicinal plant, I think we need to preserve what we've got.
When we were growing up, all the way, you know, through the water banks, there used to be a lot of cane, but now there's not that much. And I used to remember how tall they used to be, but now they seem like they're shrunk. Some people say when you don't make use of what is provided for you, it goes away. Well, my aunt, she's passed, and she used to make river cane baskets. And when I see that, I think of her. And we used to go out when we didn't have fishing rods. So we used, when we were kids, we used to go out and just cut one down, you know, and fix it and go perch fishing with those. You know, during the summer, when we were growing up, it was just me, and I had three brothers, but we always went fishing. We went crawdad hunting. So everything, any activities that we had was centered around that creek. Clear waters. We used to get our water out of the well, and they used to tell us, you know, it was pure water. But now they say, no, don't drink it. I mean, has it changed that much? I mean, I wonder, why was it safe for us to drink back then, and then they don't allow it? We have a lime plant, Marble City lime plant, and I feel that it's not really safe because it gets in the air, gets on the plants and stuff. I remember there used to be a natural spring there across the road. We would be going to Marble, to the store, and my dad let us out, and we'd get a drink of that water. Of course, the water ran free, you know, up on the ground, and we'd take our shoes off and wade, and, you know. But you can't do that anymore because it's got lime in it.
This is a medicine plant. This is gunhage. It's black, what they call it. It's used for a lot of different things, for kids and for adults. And used to, a long time ago, the way Dad used it was that he used fire and water for medicine. And he would use the root of this plant and put it in the water, then blow it on people's foreheads or back of their heads or however they used it. This one here, I'm not showing the plant itself, but it's actually what goes along with the teaching. Like if you're gathering plants or anything out in the woods. Okay, so I've dug a hole there. I've dug it up. There's your root and there's your plant laying there. That could be any hole, even if you're digging for rocks or something, you leave a hole. We were taught, I was just showing you, I'm taking a piece of hair out of my head and I put it down in the hole. And that's what we were taught is, I mean, whenever you take something, you leave something behind. It could be anything. So I choose hair because I got it with me and, you know, I can afford to lose some, so I got two hairs here. The other thing about the hair is when you put it in that hole, it's actually fertilizer. So if there's any root left, so it's actually a little fertilizer you're putting in there. And then again, after you're done, that's what we're always taught. No matter what kind of hole you dig, you always cover that hole back up. And then again, leaving something behind, you're just telling that plant to replenish or, you know, or there may be parts of that root left and it's going to grow again. This is what a Cherokee sees to me. And it could, this is the woods. There's all kinds of trees out there, leaves and bugs and animals or whatever's out there in the woods. And there's medicine out there. And this is what Cherokees like to see, is undeveloped land, is what I was saying, versus the other one. Clean cut, you know, you hate to see that. You know, they call it progress. But to me, when I see that, I think we've lost a lot. That's why a lot of Cherokees keep their land undeveloped, because of what's out there. You know, there's medicine for everything out there if you just know what it is, or ask other people or whatever. It's out there. The roots, the leaves, the bark, the grapevines. You know, all these plants, even the birds and animals, their bones, their skin, you know, all of it's medicine that lives out there. And that photograph to me, you know, it could be any woods, but that's the beauty that I see when I look out in the woods, is what am I going to see out there that's medicine? That's the beauty for me, is these woods. And in a lot of lands that the Cherokees have, it's undeveloped. It's like this right here. And there's a reason why. It's because you let, you know, the medicine grow where it's supposed to. Of course, you got to go hunt for some of it, but it's out there. And that's what I see with our health. If we could learn to use what's out there, we would be a lot healthier than what we are today.
Well, this is around my neighborhood. This is basically what I see every day when I like go to town, drive to work. I see fences everywhere I look. When I was growing up, my dad used to always talk about how when an Indian person lives or has property, they're going to care for it differently than white people will. And he said the white person is going to come in and clear off the land first before they do anything else. Whereas with Indian people, they will keep it natural as long as they can. And to me, this is a prime example of what he was talking about. Acres and acres of cleared land. So to me, there's a lot of natural plants and trees that were removed. So, you know, that would have been a lot of medicine and things. Now, when I was growing up, there wasn't that much pasture land. We would walk through people's property, and there wasn't necessarily fences. So in order to get where we were going, you know, we had a, what they call trespass, I guess, through people's properties. But it wasn't a big deal then. So when I see, you know, the fences like this, it tells me that I should stay out, that I'm not, probably wouldn't be welcome there. That was our playground, you know, the woods. So to me, that's what the kids are missing out on. I mean, there's still this type of land around here. We still have plenty of neighborhoods like that, but it's not like used to be when I was growing up. People were healthier then. I think it's just the fact that a lot of people don't practice home remedies. Back in the day when everybody, when it was all about survival for people, well, they knew a lot about home remedies, not just Indian people, but, you know, that was how they survived. And a lot of it was health maintenance, you know, drinking certain things to do a cleanse every season or whenever you were going to put a different type of food in your body. Like in the summertime, it's fresh food, or starting in the spring. Then in the wintertime, you know, you eat different types of food. It might be dried food, and you might eat more meat during that time, maybe a little more fatty stuff. So I think if we take better care of the land, then it will take better care of us. I think we're going to have to do a lot to make our lands healthier.
Okay, this one right here is what we call, in English, we call it greenbrier. And this greenbrier, you know, we take the leaves off, and if you got an infection somewhere, you just take the leaf and roll it up and just press it on wherever your infection is. That's some strong stuff right there. But you go back when I was a young kid, that was a very important medicine right there. We couldn't live without it. I mean, there's a lot, numbers of things that uses, the animal even uses that. Deer eats that in wintertime for their greenery. And maybe where the rabbits lives. But like I said, today, it don't mean nothing to us. And that's sad. Because I think there's come a day we're going to have to start back using that stuff. And we better know it. Because, you know, just like, I've heard my grandpa and my dad say, if we're not using it, God's going to take it away. To everybody else, that right there is ain't nothing but a thorn. But man, that's useful to the Cherokee people. And that's why we need to preserve it. That's what I always say. I think it should be, we should have, Cherokee Nation ought to have a designated place to have something like this, and that not nobody just go in there and destroy it and spray them. and all that stuff, you know. I think that's what it needs to happen. We've been squeezed in because even like over there where I live, people from California is buying out lands that don't know nothing about our nature and could care less about our nature because they're putting dozers on there and tearing it all up. See, this stuff needs loving just as much as me and you needs loving. This stuff needs loving too. All right, if we don't love that part right there, all right, it's going to be unhealthy. All right, today there's no connection between human and the plants. There's no connection no more. When I was a little kid, them stuff was strong. They were strong plants. I mean, I'm talking about strong stuff was growing up. But today, it's weak. See how that yellow is? Weather even tears it up. You didn't see dead trees when I was growing up like you see today. You didn't see dead plants like it is today. Everything was strong. Long time ago, they used to burn in the fall. They just get out there and just start burning it because they say it makes it stronger. It makes it healthier because the ash is like it's a natural fertilizer. And then when it rains, it goes into the ground and makes this strong. We forgot about our Mother Earth too long. I mean, we've forgot about it too long. We just don't care for it. To me, I hope whenever these people see this, or whenever they look at this, they can feel what's the same feeling that I have feeling for inside right here. I wish they could feel the same way. Then they would know they need to preserve all this stuff that we have right here. And without that, people could care less. But they're going to have the same connection that I have with our plants. And that's why I say being connected is very important. But how do we get connected? How are you going to get connected? Well, that's a journey that you got to walk in your own self. You got to find that journey. And when you find it, you'll know it. Because you're going to feel it. What we feel. While rest was filled, that's why the one that wants to preserve our medicine. But without that, you know, it's going to be gone.
The ancestors said the Creator put a spirit in the earth. There's another element that we call the air that is another most sacred element. The earth and the air in combination creates the plants that we eat and use for health. Another element that is equally as important is water. Water, the air, and the soil in combination creates the sacredness of the soil. And the water is honored as a cleansing agent as well as the air, as well as the earth. In our final importance, as far as elements are concerned, is the heat. We must honor that fire, for the fire is represented in our body. Our warm body represents that fire. We must always have a warm welcome to all things, to all people. This is the ancient teachings of our people, and because they were able to have the power, spiritual power, they honored the earth. The total planet of the earth was sacred to them, and they understood that everything that they had at that time and that we have at this time comes from the soil, comes from the earth. We need to honor the earth